Congratulations, behavior analyst, for just passing the boards. This is really important for you to know my top 14 mistakes that rookie behavior analysts make. It's urgent for you to know this. So we have new behavior analysts that are entering the workforce, and the test results just came back, so I'm super excited and very grateful that you're tuning in, because I'd like to share, you know, 28 years of mistakes that I've made. So that way, if you're a new rookie BCBA or a new rookie teacher, that I can share with you the failures that I've had that I believe you can prevent. So, rookie mistake number one by a behavior analyst. The behavior analyst comes into a classroom or into a home, and they end up creating all these demands for the parents. So they give them a data sheet, they start asking them to do this, do that, and right from the beginning, their presence is undesirable. It's unpleasant. The parents don't want them to come back. The teacher realizes that they're on salary, they're not getting paid any extra for this behavior analyst to come in and create a bunch of work for them. So the first step is really to pair yourselves with positive reinforcement. Make sure that you're not placing all kinds of demands on the parent or the teacher. Make sure that the teacher wants you there. So they won't have you come back if you just create a whole bunch of work the first visit. Number two, they're doing a functional behavior assessment, and they give the parents a data sheet or the teacher, and they collect their own ABC data, antecedent behavior consequence data, and it goes on forever. So months and months go by, and the parent or the teacher is taking antecedent behavior consequence data, and then nothing's done with it. So that's a big pain point for new BCBAs. Sometimes do that because they're overwhelmed with their caseload. Rookie mistake number three for board certified behavior analysts. They take the data and then they never actually execute on a function-based intervention. Sometimes families and teachers need you to execute. I'm not suggesting that you should jump right to a behavior plan. You need to go through the steps of a functional behavior assessment, but you have to make sure at some point you're hands-on and you execute an intervention. Okay, rookie mistake number four. Behavior analysts, often in controlled settings like a neurobehavioral stabilization program where I've worked, and I've found that behavior analysts end up creating interventions that work in a vacuum. So the intervention works really great in that one setting around that one therapist with the same stimuli, but it doesn't generalize to other settings. So that's a big rookie mistake, which is number four. Making sure, it's really important that the behavior analyst going forward make sure that they program for generalization and that the learner learns to engage in behaviors around varying stimuli. So you have to program for the real environment. Okay. Rookie mistake number five, the behavior analyst or the teacher or the parent is the recipient of a severe behavior, like they get whacked, and then the behavior analyst or the parent says, "Johnny, use your words." And then the child says, "You know, I want the toy, please." And then they give them the toy. So you would, at first it sounds like that's something that would be appropriate to ask them to use the words. But the problem is they just shaped a chain of behaviors, severe aggression, then use your words, then you get a reinforcer. So that's a common mistake. And one of the solutions to that is to have the learner engage in a bunch of other behaviors of compliance before they end up having them use their words and get a reinforcer. Otherwise, you just reinforce a chain of problems. Okay, rookie mistake number six, they don't ride out a severe extinction burst. So we all know that when the source of the reinforcer is removed after a behavior problem and you're implementing extinction, that the behavior is going to get worse before it gets better. But the problem is that a new behavior analyst or a new teacher doesn't ride out the burst, and they wait till it gets intolerable the most severe part, and then they give in because it's not possible for them to really place on extinction. So my suggestion is don't place the behavior on extinction if you're not really ready to ride it out. Rookie mistake number seven, the behavior analyst might be doing an experimental or trial-based functional analysis or just an extended analysis like the IWATA study did in the very beginning. And they're manipulating variables, and what they end up reinforcing each problem behavior on an FR1 schedule, which is typical of a functional analysis. So each time a behavior occurs, they reinforce the behavior to determine what the function is. However, the fact that it's on a continuous reinforcement or FR1 schedule, the learner never has real severe behaviors because they're being reinforced for the low intensity behaviors. So you never get to see the real behavior problems, or you get no behavior problems at all during the analog experimental analysis. Rookie mistake number eight, behavior analysts and teachers sometimes, when they're working with a learner that might be considered emotionally disturbed or behavior disorder, they end up trying to pair too much with the learner to make the learner like them, and then they end up crossing boundaries. And it looks like they're trying to be that learner's best friend or the student's best friend. So they go overboard trying to pair with the learner, and then they end up crossing and blurring over ethical lines by saying things that are inappropriate or doing things that are inappropriate just to get the learner to like them. Okay, rookie mistake number nine. Teachers and behavior analysts early off sometimes think that a punisher is ineffective because right after the punishment, there's some kind of respondent aggression, or the learner cries or gets upset or has avoidance movements or whatever it is, but they think that the punisher is ineffective because the learner had negative vocalizations and squirmed and wanted to get away. But all that really matters is the future behavior. So if the punishment works, the next time around when the behavior problem occurs, all the behavior analyst or parent has to do is warn the learner, and the learner stops engaging in the problem behavior. Therefore, you knew it worked. So punishment's defined by the future behavior decreasing. And just understand that a side effect of punishment in the very beginning might mean that you get an unpleasant response. It doesn't mean it's not working and that you should stop. Okay, rookie mistake number 10 is that behavior analysts sometimes will pander and change. It's actually unethical, but they may change their recommendations based on the person that's funding the consultation. So in other words, a parent is paying for an independent evaluation and the parent's leaning really hard in a certain direction against the school district, and the behavior analyst ends up pandering to what the parent wants rather than what's clinically appropriate for the learner, because the parent is the one paying for the evaluation, which could occur both ways. Okay, rookie mistake number 11. Behavior analysts sometimes, when they're working with learners that are emotionally disturbed or that are behavior disorder or close to typically developing learners, they end up taking it personal because the learner appears to be so typically developing and neurotypical, and they act so much like any other learner, they take it personal when the kid has a behavior problem and they think it's directed at them and they don't detach themselves. Number 12 is that as soon as you pass the board exam, you get all these offers and emails saying, you know, make $120,000 moving to JBIP, you know, make $115,000 by working per diem and moving to some other country. And just know that what's important is that the behavior analyst finds their niche and does what they love to do. Don't just end up uprooting because of an email that you get suggesting that you're going to make a lot of money, and you end up being uprooted from your family and in a place that you don't want to be because you end up leaving. Rookie mistake number 13 is that the BCBA is inflexible because behavioral science is very lawful, systematic, and it's like engineering in many ways, behavioral engineering for that matter. The BCBA becomes too rigid in their recommendations, and they don't ebb and flow with what works in the real environment. And last but not least, rookie mistake number 14 goes along those lines of being rigid. A parent, or you're in an IEP meeting and another clinician may recommend something that a behavior analyst would realize is not empirically validated or doesn't have the experimental rigor behind it. And they might, you might be in a team meeting and someone recommends RDI or floor time or something that doesn't have a whole lot of research behind it. And the behavior analyst shuts it down and says that they should not do it. Now, I'm not saying that they necessarily should do the RDI or the floor time. However, if something's working, it doesn't matter what you call it. Take good data collection and the effect on the learner. And if they're doing very well, call it whatever you want to call it. Just make sure that you operationalize the behavioral contingencies and the variables that are making it work. So who cares what they call it? If it's working, it's working. I can guarantee it's based on behavioral science.